Hello, this is Mario Aquino, and you're watching another episode of Strange Loop Chats. With me today is Hillel Wayne. Before we get started, I'd like to say a few things about Strange Loop this year, which is going to run in St. Louis from Thursday, September 30th through Saturday, October the 2nd. Tickets for in-person and virtual attendance are available through the website. In addition to Strange Loop Conference and workshops, tickets are also available for TLA Plus Conference, which is being held at St. Louis Union Station alongside the Strange Loop workshops on Thursday, September 30th. For more information, please visit thestrangeloop.com. With that out of the way, let me introduce Hillel Wayne. For anyone not familiar with him or with TLA Plus, let me say that Hillel spoke at Strange Loop in 2017, where he gave a talk titled Tackling Concurrency Bugs with TLA Plus. Viewers can watch that talk on this YouTube channel. Hillel, thank you for sitting with me for this interview.
Pleasure to be here. How can I help you?
For anyone not familiar with TLA Plus, can you give us kind of a summary? What is TLA Plus?
So let's actually start with a bit of the bigger picture first.
Okay.
Software correctness. We need to be able to write software that we want to be able to write it quickly. We want to be able to write it cheaply. We want to be able to write it that is correct, right? Generally, there are multiple different kinds of bugs. The most common kinds of bugs are what we might call implementation details, where you are essentially writing something, you mess something up, you put something in the wrong place, you're coding something and you make a small mistake. Those are the things that we try to catch with our type systems, our code review, our testing, et cetera. I'm sure you're familiar with all of that. Now, there's another class of bugs broadly that we can think of as design bugs, where you are implementing something correctly, but the thing you're implementing doesn't do what you want it to do. Maybe it fundamentally has a race condition just built into the core essence there, or maybe it doesn't actually satisfy your requirements in all cases, or maybe there is one execution which causes to shut down all servers, and you can't really say that that's a bug because it's actually part of the implementation, it's part of the features. So these are the bugs that are a lot rarer, but they're also the ones that are much more dangerous. They tend to be harder to detect. They tend to blow up much more nastily in production. And fixing them tends to take a lot more time because you have to fundamentally redesign your system. The problem with trying to solve these things with like tests and types and checking and such is that those all work on the code level. They work on an existing implementation. And these are issues you want to find before you have the implementation so you don't spend weeks and weeks implementing the wrong thing. This leads to a class of tools we call formal specification languages, which are languages you can use to express abstract models of a system and catch these design bugs before you have to start coding them. TLA Plus is one of the tools in this, and right now rapidly becoming the most popular one due to accessibility and its power. It was sort of catapulted to the main stage by Amazon Web Services when they published a paper about how they found critical bugs in S3 and DynamoDB using this, bugs that passed all their current error correction systems and only took them like a few weeks, like a weekend in one case of practice to find. That sort of got a lot more people into it, including me. I used it at a small education startup where it probably saved us months and tens or not hundreds of thousands of dollars. And that got me excited enough to start talking about it more publicly.
The approach that TLA Plus takes for doing, I guess, specification testing is through expressing specifications in the language of TLA Plus?
Yes. One way to sort of think about that is that imagine you're trying to implement, I don't know, like querying a database, right? At the really, really high level is just data is here. It is now in this value. At the actual implementation level, you have all of your like classes, you have your structures, you have this entire control flow, you have audits, you have error checking, you have probably a logging in there somewhere, you probably have some kind of dependency injection so you can swap in and out different kinds of database. And so what could be hundreds or thousands of lines of implementation code can at the really high abstract level be one or two lines of modeling code.
That actually sounds really remarkable. And I guess I would ask, how is it that things that are, I guess, components of distributed systems can be represented with such little amount of modeling code?
Because fundamentally, the idea here is that we're looking at the design. We're looking at sort of trying to find these less common but much more critical issues that exist at a much higher, more fundamental level of the system. So we can essentially abstract away all of these implementation details, that stuff that's necessary to make the system work on computers, but isn't really part of our abstract machine, our essential machine, as you might think of it.
Are there any kind of formal specification languages that TLA either builds on or relies on or changes or improves upon?
Yes. A little bit about the history of like this entire space. There's a few different branches that mostly started Viennese development method of IBM, and I believe the late 1960s. And then there were sort of some offshoots of that, primarily Zed. There was a separate branch called linear temporal logic, which was basically designed to model, essentially create a mathematical representation of how things can change. And then essentially TLA plus is a synthesis of one branch of temporal logic called temporal logic of actions with ideas from Zed and a few other places, I believe.
So time is a component of the specification. I guess the focus of the modeling that you can do with the specification language.
Yeah. The way we sort of think about systems is that we have all the things a system can do. It could, say, send a message, or it could drop a message, or it could, the queue could be reordering the messages, or something could receive a message. And then every possible execution of those actions, every possible like sequence of states that the system go through is called a behavior. Then there exists the set of all possible behaviors the system can do. And what we want to guarantee using these languages by expecting the properties is that every single possible behavior satisfies our high-level requirements. Yeah, there are other different like models of like how we specify and like how we represent models of systems. This is the TLA plus way, which tends to be very good if you have to deal with any kind of concurrency or distributed systems. It's less good for other things, and it's really a matter of choosing what your problem domain is.
Can you kind of give an example of the kind of flaw that's, I guess, maybe behavior-oriented that TLA plus would be able to catch in a distributed system?
So in the tackling concurrency bugs with TLA plus talk I gave at Strange Loop, I gave some examples of how we used it at my old workplace. And one of the examples was what's called the batch installer, where we essentially had to be moving a lot of resources across a lot of different iPads, essentially like app resources that we had a finite number of. But we were working through a system where we moved them through by large batch APIs. But this third-party system we had to work through was both eventually consistent and non-idempotent. So if we essentially sent a message saying, do this, it would be a while before the physical world reflected that reality and a while before their system reflected that reality. And also by non-idempotent, it means that if like we were in that space where we said, hey, do this, and we said, hey, do this again, it would trigger a memory leak. If we were lucky, it would trigger a memory leak. It could do other much worse things. So we had to build a system that guaranteed all resources were eventually in the right places, while also guaranteeing that we never sent a request that would trigger a memory leak by being non-idempotent, given that there was a delay between when the real world reflected what their system was and what their system was telling us.
I see.
Yeah, so a lot of places this can go wrong. And a couple of the sprints before we started using formal modeling did have major issues where in specific circumstances, it could either break idempotency or break the requirement and a resource would just be left on the table. But we were able to sort of use TLA plus to essentially create a model of a system that the first model ended up having like a 19-step error trace where if like these 90 things would go wrong, we would like enter this loop where something would just not get moved around. And then we could make a fix on that. And then the fix would turn out to like have a different issue. So we'd rethink like the design. And eventually we were able to find a design after like a couple of days of modeling that guaranteed all the properties we needed. It also gave us enough insight into what we need to do that actually building the system ended up taking like a couple weeks faster than we expected.
Hmm. So considering what you were just describing, can you, I guess, say a little bit about where TLA plus fits in a development cycle?
Yeah, so there's a few different ways people use it. This is actually a more interesting question because given that this kind of formal specification tool sort of doesn't really have any analogs in mainstream development, it's like a very large field. There's like a lot of cool ideas in it, but they're not like very common tools. And because they solve an issue that really isn't solved by anything else, when people sort of do start using these tools, they end up using them in a lot of different ways that they might not necessarily be like the best use. That may not be the best tools to do that, but because there's nothing else out there, they're best creatively misused, if that makes sense. Fundamentally, there's a couple of places that are considered the proper place to use them. So for example, before you start like writing a large amount of code, you model out the system we're going to build. It's also often used when you're trying to refactor existing code or like finding a bug where you create a model of the system to sort of figure out better where the bug is and then make the changes you expect, make sure that doesn't reintroduce a different bug. That said, because these tools kind of do something that nobody really otherwise has access to, people end up using them in a lot of different ways, sort of pushing the limits of how they can use them. For example, one of the earliest like creative misuses I found was documenting things, where you'd essentially take a system and write an executable documentation of the entire system and show how making changes would cause different impacts. I've also seen it used for people doing optimization, where they prove an optimization would not like introduce new bugs and have identical behavior before actually like implementing that optimization. I've seen people use it as a constraint solver or as like a model space like generator, where they essentially use it to just build out a state space and sort of see what the state space looks like. So there's a lot of different ways you can use it, but the ways that the majority of people use it are basically before you start implementation.
You did though describe the use of TLA Plus in, I guess, a setting once you have a working system or maybe some way into the development cycle for a system.
Yeah,
I remember either from a talk that you've given or maybe from your book how the specifications that are expressed with TLA Plus are completely separate from the application code itself. It's just a completely different thing, and it's not meant to drive the application, mm-hmm. right?
Yes.
It's just meant to represent states that a system can be in, mm-hmm. given a model that describes how the system's behaviors work, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
So I guess one question I have is, how is it that teams that use TLA Plus can try to keep the models that they use to specify a system and the system itself, how do those things remain in sync when you have a working system, either when you have a working system that TLA Plus was used to sort of design it, the behaviors of, or when you have a working system and you're sort of starting from scratch, but you get the model specification and the application itself sort of in sync, but mm-hmm. over time, the system changes and grows. How do those things, like what are the ways that people try to keep those things in sync?
Code review, lots of code review. Okay, more, less facetious than that. That is one of the core limitations of these kinds of tools, is that there's no easy way to connect them to the code. This is often intentional. It gives you more flexibility and makes these tools much easier to use. And it's generally better to get people using a tool that is, say, 10% of the effort, but only 50% of the effectiveness versus something that's like 100 times the effort and twice the effectiveness kind of thing. That said, there are techniques that people do use. One of the common ones that I've seen and I've done myself is what's called I'm not sure there's actually a proper term for this, but I sort of think of it as trace testing. So what you can do is create your model, right? And the model essentially creates a state space, right? Of like everything that can happen in the system. And then what you can do is you can turn that into, say, a JSON stream of actions and create what's called an orchestrator on your code that reads in this JSON and makes the corresponding moves in your system. Say it sees, okay, so this writer will do this thing. So we all send now a message to this writer and have it make this like operation. Then essentially what happens is you then check that what the system does, what your code does matches what the abstract TLA Plus model does, modulo like translation between the data layers. I've seen this actually used really, really effectively at some places. The main downside is that you kind of have to handroll it for the particular system you're working on. So we can't make any general third-party libraries, or at least nobody has.
Yeah, I guess figuring out a way for the specification to either drive system-level tests or to use the specification to confirm that the system behaves as the model expects it to, I feel like mm-hmm. those things would be, like having some approach for tackling those problems would help teams use the tool in a way so that there's not a lot of divergence
right.
between the two, right?
I should emphasize though that while divergence can happen, it's also something that can be solved at the human level with like better processes. Mm-hmm. And more fundamentally, I think it is important to note that while this would take what we can do with this stuff to the next level, what we can do currently, even with like code and spec diverging, is still much, much, much more valuable than we can do without it. It would make a good thing great. It wouldn't make an unacceptable thing acceptable, if that makes sense. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So as I've been thinking about TLA Plus, like one of the things that occurred to me was whether TLA Plus is either like a proofer or a compiler for state machines that represent distributed systems. Would you say that's a fair analogy?
I would not. So the first thing I want to mention here is that there is actually a language that sort of you write specifications and it compiles them to actual state machine code. Hmm. The most famous in this category is actually P, as in Papa by Microsoft Research. which essentially creates C-sharp code based on abstract state machine specifications. TLA plus itself is just essentially a notation for describing systems. Then we have model checkers or proof systems that then take those models of the system and verify that they have properties. So I guess the main like thing I actually want to relate it to is Z3, but that's probably not very useful either because that's also like a tool in this space. So I guess maybe the best way to describe it would essentially be like a configuration language that generates a test suite almost. But that's like, honestly, it's honestly kind of hard to come up with good analogies here because this is like a tool that like does something we don't really do otherwise. So like all the analogies in some way end up breaking down a bit.
Hmm. Yeah, that's not uncommon, right? Where you've got analogies that are leaky in one way or another to try to just communicate an idea, especially one that's sort of novel and unlike other things too. Where is it that folks can learn more about TLA Plus?
So first of all, if you are coming to Strange Loop, we still have like space open for the TLA Plus conference, which happens the day before. So there are essentially three resources. Actually, before I did the Strange Loop talk, I was sort of excited about this that I wrote an online documentation, learntla.com. That one I was updating from about like 2017 to 2018. I'm currently a little bit unsatisfied with it, but I haven't been able to update it because afterwards I got a book deal to write Practical TLA Plus. And I think this is currently the best introduction to TLA Plus. A lot of pedagogy went into it. It is full of practical examples of how to how to write specs, how to actually apply it to business problems, how to use it for like modeling requirements or distributed systems or data structures, et cetera. I think that's the strongest one. I don't think it'll be the strongest as of 2022 because I'm going to take the stuff I learned in the past 4 years to like completely revamp Learn TLA Plus. I'm scheduled to start doing that in my like planner starting 2022. And then finally, if you want to sort of go to the source and like learn the canonical text to like learn fundamentally what's going on versus something more focused on getting you applying it, there are Specifying Systems by Leslie Lamport. This is actually free too. If you download the TLA Plus toolbox, it is included as a free PDF. Hmm. And it's a little bit more advanced and I think requires a bit more like comfort with mathematical ability and approaches it sort of in a bit of a different way. But it also like is the reference text that people use to like understand how the system works and like how to resolve certain questions.
So Hillel, I want to thank you for sitting with me for this interview. It's been really enjoyable talking to you. Mm-hmm. For anyone watching this video, as I mentioned at the beginning, if you're interested in Strange Loop Conference, tickets are available for both in-person and virtual attendance. The workshop day for the conference is going to be Thursday, September 30th. That's the same day as the TLA Plus conference.
And I would like to point out that if you're not going to the TLA Plus conference, Paul Swanson is going to have a really cool workshop on busy data, which is essentially like Vim for spreadsheets. It is an extremely cool piece of technology. You should definitely check it out.
Thank you for watching. Well, thanks again for sitting for the interview.
Thank you for having me.